As I was completing my undergraduate education at Georgetown University in Washington, D.C., I too was asking myself these questions, trying to plan for the next steps in life. Was India the right place for me to go back to build a life and career? This period of questioning arose at a time when all my friends were running from one networking event to another. This was at the height of the recruiting season. And we were no longer young, fun-loving college students, but we were moving on to the next phase in life. The rubber had finally hit the road, and some of my friends were already getting juicy offers from big corporates as well as leading organizations all over the world. Amidst all this, I decided to return home, to come back to Delhi, to read law at the Faculty of Law at Delhi University. A confluence of factors affected my decision. Of course, in college, having been deeply involved with lots of India-related activities, being in touch with developments back at home through the news, through talking to my parents on the phone, talking to friends, well-wishers, as well as my various visits home, these all influenced it. But the rationale for my decision was threefold, and that is what I wish to talk to you about today. Today, India is being transformed at a very rapid pace. And this is not just when it comes to the economic development of the country. That has been accumulating over the past 20 to 25 years. But in the societal and cultural attitudes that our country possesses today, the aspirations of the country are also growing by leaps and bounds. Then number two, today the world's eyes are on India. From my 4 years studying in the US, as well as time spent in China, through numerous conversations with professors, with fellow students, with taxi drivers, everybody the world over has their eyes on our country, and everybody is looking as to where we are going. And thirdly, but most importantly, I believe, was the self-realization that young people in this country today can make an impact on a large scale, whether the returns may be measured in gold, social change, or the advancement of the nation-building exercise that our founding fathers set us on. However, taking a step back, at the time I was deliberating this decision, there was, of course, a series of doubts that arose in my mind. Here I was in Washington, D.C., the political capital of the world, the lawyer capital of the world, definitely breathing much cleaner air than I do these days back in Delhi, studying things I was immensely passionate about. I majored in international politics with a focus on the rise of China, studying it from various prisms, from military, from economics, from international law, as well as their language. I got the unique opportunity to also study in Beijing for two summers, which is about 4 months, as I did my language training over there. In addition to that, at college, I took various very interesting courses from understanding energy markets to national security law. Also took very interesting classes in theology, history, you name it. At college, you also got the unique opportunity to interact with many luminaries being in Washington. From taking classes with former advisors to presidents, to listening to former presidents, presidential candidates. Donald Trump didn't visit our college, thankfully, but Hillary and Bernie did. Then countless senators, countless congressmen, ambassadors, and we were also once given a lecture on intelligent investing by Warren Buffett himself. However, given all this, I took the plunge. I decided to return home against applying for jobs in the US. Today, I wish to share with you, with all of you seated here, as well as the larger platform that TED provides me with, as to what really attracted me back to this land, and why I'm incredibly positive about the future of young people in this country. Also, there are always going to be challenges, and our country faces very big challenges, and I shall also address this part. So I start with the positives. So what are young people actually doing today? Zomato, Ola, Flipkart, ICANN, Youth Ki Awaaz, Grubfest, Global Citizen Festival. these are all new organizations. Some of them famous, some not very famous. But these are markers of what can be done in this country. The what type of impact can be made. You can become a billionaire in this country. You can make a big impact. And these are great models for the people who are coming in to the generation, people like you and me, because we believe we can make it. No longer are the youth of this country aspiring for stable jobs, which provide you with security in life, a pension. The young people of our country want to be at the cusp of the transformation of this great country. And we want to use the springtime of our lives to make a positive impact and do very well for ourselves as well. If you look at last year's Forbes 30 under 30 list, it's a list of where 30 people who are under the age of 30 who have already achieved remarkable things with their lives. So I just want to give you this illustration to show what people are actually doing so that you are aware. There's people who are utilizing technology to provide rural healthcare, to improve logistics, because there's so much e-commerce coming up in our country today, to help the government with its, to provide cybersecurity for the government. People are also using their skills to help corporates reduce their carbon footprint, as well as formalize erstwhile informal sectors, such as the Kabadi network. This is happening in South India today. Out of these 30 people, you'll also be surprised that 12 out of these 30 were on the creative side. And none of these people, you would never have heard of any of these people. I certainly hadn't heard of any of these people while I saw the list. And this just proves that in today's day and age, even if you're a creative person, you do not need to run to Bombay for, to get your first break. You do not need a godfather in the industry to get your first break, to who provides you with your first commission. You can use various platforms, online platforms that exist in this country today that provide people with opportunities to showcase your talent, be it showcasing your art, your music, your short films, or even comedy. Now, speaking about comedy, India in the last 5 to 7 years has seen the meteoric rise of a industry in the entertainment space that it hasn't seen ever before. You know, earlier used to find my stand-up comics only at certain open mics here and there, but today you'll find them in your daily lives because you'll be constantly recalling, you know, this is what this guy said the other day, this is what this guy, the other guy said the other day. I'm sure all of you would have seen Veer Das's podcast, you would have seen Zakir Khan's various routines, you would have seen AIB's infamous roast, as well as Biswa and Kanan Gill's various pretentious movie reviews. And I want to tell you, moving back, that this is an incredible reflection upon how our young republic is maturing. It's learning to laugh at itself. It's learning not to take everything so seriously. And this is incredibly important. And it's young people not much older than you and I, who have made this difference. And there is a place in this country for people who are creative, people who want to pursue their passion. In politics and in public policy, you're seeing an infusion of young blood. Earlier, one always has this traditional stereotype that politics has always been the preserve of rotund government babus. But today, thanks to forward-looking members of parliament, members of legislative assemblies, the Niti Aayog, Invest India, you name it, there are numerous young people who are savvy with technology, who have come with big degrees in policy. Everyone is getting involved in this nation-building process. In addition to that, there's a number of policy think tanks, there's a number of institutes that are all coming up, which are all flush with masters and PhD students, as well as bachelor students, with degrees in development studies, psychology, public policy, you name it. Now, the important thing to understand after saying all this is that we also are the demographics of our country serve as important tailwinds for this push forward. Today, India Today, the first generation born after the 1991 economic reforms is starting to enter the workforce. Now, you have to understand that 25 years ago, our GDP was $280 billion. Today, it's almost $2.5 trillion. So, over these 25 years, everybody has seen a jump in their standard of living year on year, and people's aspirations to improve their lives year on year will obviously help in part fuel the economy. In addition to this, we are also far better educated than the previous generation, not individually, I must say, but in terms of the mass number of people who are educated. Many of our generation's people's parents would never have been educated, but today that is the difference. And most importantly, the women of our generation are far better educated because erstwhile there was no opportunities that were given. And this is not only important because they add to the workforce. It's not a number, it has massive, massive social implications. Because they can make, when they have financial independence, the balance of power at home shifts to the center as women start adding to the family income. In addition to that, when they have their own financial independence, the independent choices that they start making also come to the fore. What to wear, whom to marry, when to marry, these are all their decisions which cannot be forced on them by society's expectations. In addition to this, the government of the day as well is business. However people may abuse them, they're doing tremendous amount of work in building the core infrastructure of our country, be it electricity access to people, be it road connectivity, as well as bringing down the costs of data in this country, which has given large number of people internet access today in today's information economy, which is vital. Then moving to how the world sees us, as the West is becoming more and more insular by the day, today people are looking at India from not only a business perspective but also a strategic perspective. Today India has become the battleground for the world's two largest e-commerce companies. One is Alibaba, the other is Amazon. Why is this? It's simply because we, every year on year, our disposable incomes are growing and we are becoming bigger and bigger consumers. So naturally, the world will have their eyes on us. Big investors, I can give you one example, such as his name is Masayoshi Son, the owner of SoftBank. He's the person who invested $20 million in Alibaba 15 years ago and exited with a $90 billion stake. So people like him are coming to India and saying, I have a 10-year plan. So when serious-minded people who know what they're talking about are expressing an interest and seeing this as an opportunity which is primed only for growth, people have to get up and listen. They listen, something serious, something good, something progressive is happening in this country. And, you know, it's not, many people dismiss it as a politically motivated marketing gimmick, but something is actually happening, boss. And we have to take it seriously. When it comes to strategy, the US now, President Trump in his recent speech mentioned that he wants India to take a larger role in Afghanistan. They're helping us equip our ports in Visakhapatnam to expand our presence in the Indian Ocean region to curb the China's adventurism in the region. So even strategically, we are being taken very seriously. So all in all, everything is like, things are looking up for our country today. Be it examples of what young people are doing in business, in politics, in media, in sport, as well as, and this is all buttressed by the government's help, as well as the world, what I've spoken about it. But now, obviously, it's not a rosy picture that I want to paint for you guys today. So it's important also to look at the challenges. Now, I'm not blindly optimistic about this country. If one just believes the upside, then that would be rather foolish. Hundreds of millions of our fellow countrymen languish in poverty. Most of them would never even have heard of Amazon, Flipkart, forget the other companies. Our farmers still pray to the rain gods for a good harvest. The air quality in this country is abysmal. In Delhi, it's worse than smoking 4 packs of cigarettes a day, I tell you. The state infrastructure is certainly not up to the mark, especially in its health and education service deliveries. We saw that with the recent unfortunate tragedy in Gorakhpur, where 60 babies died due to bureaucratic lapses. When it comes to education, I myself study at one of the prestigious law university colleges in this country. But it's very sad to say that the infrastructure doesn't look like it's improved much since the time the British have left. In addition to that, today we are seeing an unfortunate resurgence in Hindu-Muslim division, where our poor brethren are being attacked and killed for not for anything wrong that they've done, but based on what they eat, what they look like. Is that a way to go? On top of that, our patriotism is being tested away. The Supreme Court recently ordered all of us to stand before movies for our national anthem. Now, we don't need to go every day and say that, boss, I'm patriotic, I will sing a national anthem. That is for them, it's within us, right? And this is all while, you know, there's numerous secessionist movements happening in this country, be it in Kashmir, be it in the East, in the Maoist affected areas, or in Nagaland. There was a peace deal struck, but many say that that was rather faulty. The challenges indeed are grave in this country. And many of my friends from the West would find it very hard to comprehend how one can be so positive in a land where there is much cause for dismay. Now, believe me, I did not return to India because of some inner calling or to perform some kind of act of messianic patriotism. But I returned because I honestly believe that our country is at an inflection point. And it has been at one for some time now. I honestly believe that for ambitious young Indians, there is no better place to be at this moment than their homeland. Because I believe that the winds of progress have already set sail, and there is plenty of blue sky on the horizon. Now, I think one thing we can all agree on is that one thing India leads the world on is cricket. Okay, so recently I went for a match in Delhi. And somehow we found ourselves driving up to the stadium right behind the bus of the Indian cricket team. As we entered the last stretch leading up to the Feroz Shah Kotla, which is the stadium in Delhi, it was a carnival of cacophony. From grandparents to grandchildren to from the not so well off to the supremely well off. Everyone was hooting and cheering as the pride of their nation rolled in to take on the New Zealand Black Caps. Now, this was a great moment. It betrayed a sense of the people's reciprocity. Just as the Indian cricket team represents us wearing the blue uniform with honor, the people support the team with an equal fervor. Similarly, today India is rife with opportunity. And if we young people till this land with honesty, integrity, hard work, teamwork, innovation, you name all these values, and try to be the best versions of ourselves, our motherland will certainly bestow upon us rich fruits in equal measure. People will continue to ask questions, just as I did at the start of this talk. That, you know, are we really moving forward? Can I achieve my dreams over here? Will the bad loans problem ever end? Will the pollution ever abate? And so on. But the important thing for us to recognize today is where we are, at what golden opportunity we have today in this country. Have a questioning spirit, but recognize and act. That is what I would urge all of you to do. Just as Churchill said long years ago, and I'm going to read this quote out and end on this note. Come on now, all you young men and women all over the world, 20 to 30, these are the years. Don't be content with things as they are. The earth is yours in the fullness thereof. Don't take no for an answer. Never submit to failure. Do not be fobbed off with mere personal success or acceptance. You will make all kinds of mistakes. But as long as you are generous and you are true and also fierce, you cannot hurt the world or even seriously distress her. She was made to be wooed and won by youth. She has lived and thrived only by repeated subjugation.